Well, good day and welcome to Faith Baptist Church. Again, we're just so glad to have you here today. If this is your first time with us, I'd like to just ask you if you wouldn't mind taking a moment and ensuring that you fill out a visitor card today. If you didn't get one and you need one, just raise your hand real high real quick. And I know I won't be able to see it right now as this recording, but somebody will see that this morning and they'll make sure you get a visitor card and just fill that out. We can make sure that gets to me so that we can thank you for coming today. Also, this is your first time tuning in online. We'd like the same for you. If you'd be willing to email me or our church at fbciwakuni@gmail.com. Again, that's fbciwakuni@gmail.com. We sure appreciate that. And that would just give us the opportunity to be able to thank you for tuning in today. But more important than any of those things, our primary concern is that you would know for sure that you have your sins forgiven and a home in heaven. And we understand today that that comes only through what the Bible talks about, a real relationship with the Father through Jesus Christ in salvation. And so what that means is that we have repented of our sin. We turn from our sin and our self-righteousness to and we rest our entire faith for forgiveness and security in the finished work of Jesus Christ and what Jesus did for us in his death, burial, and resurrection. This is what the Bible clearly says in many places. If today, if you're resting in your works, or if today you're resting in your ability to please God, or if you're resting in religion or your family religion or even your familial service to the Lord, these things do not save you. They might be good things in and of themselves, but they're not anything that you can rest in as a secure place for your soul to be saved, redeemed, and born again. And what we're talking about today, and if you'd like to take your Bibles today and turn to John chapter 16, we've been speaking about this thought, the Holy Spirit's toolbox. And the things that the Holy Spirit uses to sanctify us and help us. Now, understand, sanctification, the process by which we are made or molded into the image of Christ, is a process of time. And it takes diligent sowing. And what I mean by sowing as far as planting, we plant good, godly, Holy Spirit-led faithfulness and doing because of our relationship with Christ. And as we do things that please the Lord, as we're led by the Spirit of God, those things produce fruit in the life of the believer. Now, let's kind of preface this. We've been talking about this for several weeks now, but I don't want to lose sight of the essential focus of our Sunday morning times, okay? And so we want to be fruitful believers. If we're in John 16, you look over in John 15, and we're going to stand in just one moment to read our passage, but I just want you to see this before we get started this morning. John 15, Jesus says, "I am the true vine, my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit." Now understand, this is a referral to the fact of that Jesus came initially here up to the Jews. As the nation of Israel, he's the Messiah. He's not just their Messiah, thank the Lord. He's our Messiah too. And without going into too much detail on that this morning, understand that because Israel rejected their Messiah, that opened the door into the sovereignty of God for the Gentiles to be, as we call, grafted in to this tree of righteousness. And so we're able to abide in the Lord as well. Now, so understand the context of this passage is Jesus speaking to those that were following him that day during his earthly ministry, predominantly the Jewish people, and he's in a general sense addressing the Israeli nation. And so these are God's people that he's coming to. They're going to reject him. They're going to crucify him. And he's going to be rejected of them. But that is going to be part of the plan of God to open the door, as he promised to Abraham back in the book of Genesis, for everyone to be able to have a chance to be redeemed to God by Jesus Christ. Excuse me. And so when you look here, he talks about what we're looking at as far as the general sense, we look at fruit, okay? And so in verse number 5, he says, "I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing." Now, of course, contextually, we're talking about the nation of Israel. The fact that Jesus is saying, look, you've been an unfruitful vine, Israel. Maybe we'll visit that one day to give some understanding, because if we misinterpret the context of passages, we can end up with some crazy doctrine. But when we look at this passage, we can glean some principles from it that help us with our study as far as how the Holy Spirit works in believers today. And primarily, what he's saying here in verse 5, that as we abide in him, as we abide in his presence and in his fellowship and in his pleasure, then we are able to bring forth much fruit. And that is our goal today. You see in verse number 8, because this is ultimately our motivation here, and is my Father glorified that you bear much fruit. For without me, or so shall you be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. And so we want to be able to please the Lord. We want to live for God. We want to bring fruit for God, because we want to bring glory to God. That is the motivation. And so as believers now in the New Testament, there's a shift here, okay? After Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, and the empowering of the church the day of Pentecost, we find that now the focal point up until the book of Revelation, chapter number 2, is the local church that has been established in Christ. And so that's what we're a part of today. And as a part of the church, we are to be fruitful as a part of the body of Christ. And so Jesus, knowing that that was coming, and that time was coming, and that this would be a progressive process of sanctification in the life and mind of the believer, we see in chapter 16, as he teaches the disciples, who would be the foundational pillars of the church, okay? You find in chapter 16, he says in verse number 7, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, expedient for you that I go away." So he's going to tell them something very important. And this is the point now where we're going to enter into our scripture, and then we're going to move into the thought today of passionate prayer. This thought of passionate prayer. The Holy Spirit uses prayer in our lives to help us. And we're going to look at that today. So if you found your place now, John chapter 16, let's go ahead and stand together in honor of this first reading of God's word here for our text. And in John chapter 16, verse number 7, starting there, watch along with me. "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. But if I depart, I will send him unto you. And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin, and of righteousness, and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father, and ye see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself." Now, this is where we're going to key in here, and we'll visit in just a moment. So really pay attention now. "But whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and shall show it unto you. All things that the Father hath are mine. Therefore said I that he shall take of mine, and shall show it unto you." Let's pray. Father, we come to you now. We thank you, God, for your word. And Lord, we thank you for the great blessed gift of your Holy Spirit. Your Holy Spirit who leads and guides and directs by your will and by your mind. God, we thank you that though we might not understand the entirety of the concept of the Godhead, because it's foreign to our hearts and minds, Lord, we thank you for it, that you, by your Spirit, can be at presence in our lives each and every day. And I pray, God, that we would live and walk in the Spirit today. I pray that we would be sensitive to his leading, that we would understand that as he leads through the word of God, he is guiding us in your mind what you'd have us to do. So God, help us to grasp this truth today. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. So the Holy Spirit's toolbox for sanctification, passionate prayer. Now, as I was in high school going into college, okay, one of the thoughts on my heart, and I know is on the heart of many a teenager, is what am I going to do with my life? At some point, you wake up from the Legos and video games and realize, man, life is about way more than these things. And there are responsibilities coming on the horizon. There are opportunities coming on the horizon. And one of the great junctions in my life, my senior year of high school, as I was graduating, I was planning to go to Bible College in Powell, Tennessee at Crown Bible Crown College. As I was planning to go there to Crown College, I was working a semester off and saving some money to help pay for that first semester. Well, during that time, I went on a lunch break. And as I was on the lunch break, and if I didn't say so, and you're already in your soul standing, I apologize. Please be seated. I really do apologize about that. I try to remind myself that just because I can't see you doesn't mean you might not still be standing. Amen. Anyway, so as I'm working for college, as I'm working a job, I went for lunch one day at a place called the Mokiteki in Misawa, Japan. It's kind of a cafe that's on the base, that's underneath of the Senior Servicemen Center, where you can play games and things like that. And they had the best calzones. And I would go there about once a month and go there and save up a little bit of money and go and get a calzone and then eat for that on 2 days. And I loved it. I thought it was an amazing meal. Anyway, so as I'm there, I noticed there was this gentleman who was having so much trouble with his computer. He looked very frustrated. And so I walked over to his table and I'd asked him, I said, "Sir, is everything okay? Can I help you?" And he said that he was having some trouble with connections for his internet on his computer. I thought, well, I've been working on, taking some classes in school, I'm doing some things here, maybe I might be able to help him. Well, we both spent 20 minutes wrestling with this computer, and we couldn't figure out for any reason why it would not hook up to the network at the Mokiteki Cafe there. So we changed a bunch of different settings and did a bunch of that, most of which is obsolete now. But I told him, "I'm sorry I couldn't help you, I don't see any reason why it shouldn't be working. Maybe he had some kind of problem, an internal thing, and it may have been a hardware issue." Because it wasn't reading anything at all. And he thanked me for my time, and I went back to my calzone. Well, while I was there, a gentleman walked over to my table and sat down and said, "Excuse me, can I talk with you for a second?" I said, "Sure." As I was talking to him, he told me about how he watched me handle that gentleman's technical problem. He heard the things I said and said, you're tracking. He's probably got a hardware issue. There's nothing you could have done to help him. He said that was a really good attempt to help him in that regard. He said, "You might not know me. I work with a lot of the base networking systems, and I'm looking for some people that I could bring on to be base administrators to help me handle the base networks as it continues to grow." And I thought, wow, what an awesome opportunity. And he said, "You might not end up here." He said, "But I'd like to have you try to come here." And he said, "In order to do that, you've got to go to school for this." And he said, "So here's my card, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you an application. I'm going to submit it through the system, and then in about a month, you'll be able to go to Texas and go to school at the training school there. And then after about 8 months, they'll send you back here, and you'll be on a contract." And I thought, wow, that sounds like an amazing opportunity. And immediately, as I began to think about what this guy was telling me, and he was giving me an idea of how much I'd make, and how long it would take to get back, and what that might mean for me and as a career. And I thought, wow, Lord, I've got some decisions to make. And then it hit me. I'm going to Bible college. And why am I going to Bible college? I'm going because I believe with all my heart that God had called me to do ministry. Now, what I'm doing today was not what was in my mind then. God has led step by step. But the point of all that is this: that you're going to have opportunities, and as young people become adults, and as adults navigate life, we always have in our mind's eye, what am I going to do with my life? And the Lord says here, not only will He talk about things from a God's perspective, but what He's inferring here as well is that God is going to give His Spirit, the Spirit of Truth, God's Holy Spirit, to help us not only navigate our walk with God and understand things to come in our walk with God, but also He will help us to navigate the will of God. Now, we'll see that throughout today, but understand that it is through prayer primarily, that we communicate with the Lord, and then the Lord communicates through His Spirit to us by use of the Word of God, as we've been speaking of the last several weeks. And I wanted to go back to this main passage. Why? Because we get this misunderstanding that because it feels right, or because maybe I have an idea that it might be right, that it must be okay with God. And so what I have to do is make sure that I'm not pushing my will, but rather submitting to God's will. And that is of utmost importance. That is, as a believer, if we're going to bring fruit for the Lord, we must obey the Lord. If we're following our own life, if we're following our own heart or our own experiences, we can be led astray. The Bible says that our hearts are evil and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Because we can be led astray. Matter of fact, in the Old Testament, over and over again, it is said of the children of Israel that they did that which was right in their own eyes. And that is not said as a commendation. As you read each of those passages, you find that it is because they were in wickedness. They were doing what they wanted to do, what was right to them, but they were not willing to submit themselves to the will and way of God. And we need to be careful of that, especially as individuals in churches, as believers, but also as a church body. We don't try to push an agenda, or that we don't try to force our desires or our will, but rather we submit to the leadership of God. We let Him guide us. We follow the authorities He puts in our life. And we let God have the preeminence in all of these situations. If I have to force something to happen, odds are it is not of the Lord, and it creates a lot more trouble than it's worth. And so, in John chapter 16, we got a kind of a preface there. Now let's go over to Colossians chapter 1 and really dig into the meat of this today. Colossians chapter 1 and verses 1 through 11. And in Colossians chapter 1, if I can keep getting there, I keep missing the page. Verse number 1 says, Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae, grace be unto you, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. So Paul is giving a general greeting here, like at the top of any kind of letter that you'd write. But what he's saying in this letter is he's saying, look, I have heard something about you. I've heard that you are saints, okay, so that you're saved, you're believers. Number two, that you're faithful brethren in Christ. You're a faithful people serving and loving the Lord with all your heart. And he says that to you, I want you to have grace. Grace from God, strength to accomplish the things of God, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And so he's trying to help them understand, look, I am in your corner. I think that you're faithful. I think you're doing a great job. And I want God to give you all the strength you need to continue and to rest your hearts in peace. And so that's going to be kind of the thrust moving forward of trying to build that and strengthen that in this church body. And so he says in verse 3, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. You know, there's a great importance to thankful prayer. This was prayer that Paul was expressing here, that he was thankful for the saints, for the saved individuals that were a part of the church in Colossae. He was thankful for them. And it's important that our prayer be thankful prayer. How many times are you and I guilty of coming before God with a gimme prayer? What I mean by that is that God, give me, give me, give me. God, help me, help me, help me. God, give me, give me, give me. But we don't stop to thank God and spend adequate time thanking God for what He has done. Oh, the time I've been guilty that when God has done something in my life, and then I turn around and I don't even thank Him for it. I feel like one of the lepers that came to Jesus and saw His healing, and He healed them all. And as they ran back rejoicing, only one turned back to worship the Lord and thank Him for the great gift of healing. And Jesus marveled at that. And yet, how many times are we that way? How many times does God intervene or provide, and we almost take it as if it's supposed to be that way, as if God, it's expected that God would do that. Boy, when the Holy One of Heaven stoops Himself to interject Himself into our lives in a very personal, specific way, we ought to stop and give Him worship and praise. We ought to thank Him. You know, the Bible says in Psalm 95, 1 through 3, O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before His presence with thanksgiving, and make a joyful noise unto Him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. You know, this thought of a psalm here, these psalms are kind of like what when David entered back into the city, And the choirs were singing, and they said, you know, David or Saul has slain his thousands, but David is 10,000s. And they were exalting David as a warrior for Israel. And this thought of Psalms is something that magnifies God. It exalts him. It lifts him up. It makes him big in the eyes of everyone. And that's what David is saying in Psalm 95. He's saying, let us exalt God. Let's extol him. Let's make him big. Let's magnify him with a joyful noise. And we ought to be a joyful people. Man, if God is at work in your life, you ought to be a joyful person. Why? Because the God of heaven is at work in your life. And so it ought to be the fact that it's a joyful noise because of the security we have in salvation. He's the rock of our salvation. And let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Oh, let us not come with our hands out looking for something from God, but let us enter the throne room of grace with our hands up, praising him for what he has accomplished in our lives. We need to make a joyful noise unto him with psalms. Why? Because the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. He is worthy of our praise and our gratitude today. And so the importance of thankful prayer is that by thankful prayer we would enter into his presence with gratitude. It's also the importance of thankful prayers and that we are encouraging the praise of the Lord. Psalm 107, 21 through 22 says, oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful work to the children of men. And let them sacrifice the sacrifices of thanksgiving and declare his works with rejoicing. Oh, we ought to declare and praise the goodness and workings of God to the children of men. And what he means by that is not that we keep our prayers silent to ourselves and our praise silent to ourselves, but we ought to be so vocal about the goodness of God in our lives. And let me ask a question today, and this is something I try to ask myself often to keep myself in check, because it's so easy to fall into this rut. But who have I shared the goodness of God with this week, last week? What answer to prayer have I taken to the Lord? You say, well, Pastor, no, I don't have any answers to prayer. Oh, you don't? Nothing to praise God for? Really? God has done nothing in your family's life? It's just been humdrum and same old, same old? May I submit that maybe it's because we don't spend adequate time in prayer, seeking God's face and direction and wisdom, praising him for what he has done, but also asking him for things that only he can do. I'm not saying that our prayers must only consist of praise and thankfulness and gratitude, but they ought to always be foundational. Those things ought to always be foundational in our prayer. And why? Because as we share the goodness of God, and as we magnify God and his greatness, it encourages the praise of the Lord in others and exalts him in somebody else's life. You know, I've often been encouraged in church where, as a young man growing up and as a young boy even in church, we'd have testimony time. And you know, it always kind of bothered me when testimony time became praise time for man. You know, well, I'm thankful for brother so-and-so or sister so-and-so, and I just want to give testimony about this church and what it's done in my life. And those are okay things. There's nothing wrong with that per se. But I really think we ought to do more during testimony times and during praise times to really just lift up the name of God and what he's done through those things. If it weren't for God, there wouldn't be a brother or sister so-and-so. If it weren't for God and his work, there wouldn't be a church to work in your life. It's God that gets these things accomplished. He deserves the glory and praise. And so as we lift up God, and as people would give testimonies of God's goodness, it would often strengthen my heart with the thought of, well, if God can do it in their life, maybe surely he can do it in mine. And boy, how many times has God met me? How many times has God met you? And who out there might be waiting to hear how God worked in your life so that their faith might be strengthened to trust God with the storm of their life? Encouraging the presence of, or entering the presence of the Lord, we ought to be entering with thankful prayer in the presence of the Lord. We ought to have thankful prayer that encourages the praise of the Lord. And we ought to have thankful prayer that is encouraging the priority of lavish gratitude. Philippians chapter 4, verses 5 through 7 say this, let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. In other words, people should look at your life, and they should look at your life, and they should be able to evaluate the way you live from a visual perspective and say that person is living urgently. That person is living with purpose. Notice what he said. Let your moderation be known unto all men. My life ought to be controlled by the Spirit of God with a sense of urgency. Why? Because the Lord is at hand. He could return at any moment. I remember when I was in college, the pastor of the church that has the college was teaching one day in a seminar class. And while I was sitting there in this class called Practical Theology, it was where he would just give pastoral advice on leadership and on church governance and on the Bible and following the Lord in these things. And try to encourage and equip us for things to come. And I've often looked back on those things I've learned to look for help in some situations. But I remember him teaching one day, and as he was teaching, he made a comment about this thought of the Lord working. And as he was teaching, I remember him saying something along the lines of how God would help us to be mindful of his coming. And he gave this illustration about that, where he said one day he was out doing some errands in town. And while he was out doing errands in town, and then he went, while he was away, he came back later in the afternoon, and he'd heard from one of the men that something humorous had happened while he was away. And he asked him what it was, and he said, I noticed that in the offices everybody was so relaxed, and everybody was taking their time, and everybody was just kind of milling about doing things as they would at their own pace. But then they saw the pastor's car drive up, and man, they got busy. I mean, papers were shuffling that weren't shuffled before, and folks were scampering back and forth. Pastor's coming. Is this done? Da, da, da. And they're getting all this stuff done. Why? Well, one, they respected the man who was pastoring the church. They respected his leadership, and they honored him for that. But more importantly, they were concerned that they'd be perceived as not being busy. And, you know, it's a funny illustration and all. But it's just a reminder, if we would do that for a pastor and want to be busy for someone of earthly leadership, boy, how much more for God? How much more for God, who is our heavenly authority, who is ultimate authority, and who leads and guides in every situation? Man, we ought to be busy about the Father's business. And this is what he's saying. The Lord is at hand. Now, and because of this, the distraction that could be there in Philippians chapter 4, he says, be careful for nothing. This thought of being careful means stressing or anxiety. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your request be known to God. He's saying, look, you ought to be busy in this life doing for God. And if there comes a need, don't be anxious. Don't stress. But bring it to God with thanksgiving. Let your request be known to God. Let your request be made known unto God. Talk to him about your needs. And bring it with thanksgiving for what he's already done. You know, it's an amazing reality that the times I begin to worry or stress about the needs of life, I try to apply this verse, and I'll go to God and think about the things I'm thankful for. This week I've been trying to think about the reality that God has blessed us with another little boy. I'm thankful that he's healthy. I'm thankful that my wife seems to be healthy afterwards. I'm thankful for the beauty and the miracle of what life is, and the fact that he could even be born is a miracle of God. Why? Because God created and made the process the way that it is. And it's just an amazing, mind-blowing thought. And so when I come to him for the thought of a need, I should ought to come to him first with a thought of gratitude. Oh God, you've already done so much for me. God, look at the blessings I have on this hand. Look at the blessings I have on this hand. Boy, life's difficult right now, and there's a whole lot of crazy going on. But Lord, you've been so good to me. You've provided for me. You've met me. You've taken care of my family before. And so, God, I'm going to trust that you'll do it now. There's a real need in our life. And I'm not going to worry or stress. I'm just going to rest in you. And when we do, the Bible says in Philippians 4, verse 7, the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. You see, when we reconcile the goodness of God in the days past and the faithfulness of God in the days present, it gives us great hope and great stability by God in days to come. Now think about what Jesus was saying back in John chapter 16. He'll show you things to come. The Lord is in the business of not giving us every detail of what's to come down the pipe. The Lord often gives us just enough to go on to, as we rest in Him, to move forward valiantly as we rest in and lean on Him. But He does not give us the big picture long view, because we might miss something in the short. For example, if you think about it this way, God could give us the airplane ride view. He could take us from New York to Los Angeles and say, look, this is where you are, so you're going to be going. And He could just give us that all the time. But if you get in a car and drive from New York to Los Angeles, you're going to see the arches of St. Louis. You're going to see the mountains of Colorado. You're going to see the Grand Canyon, maybe, or the Redwoods. You're going to see beautiful sights along the way, things that you wouldn't have seen before. And so God often gives us enough to get us from point A to point B while He leads us to point B. And there are things that God wants to use in our life along the way to lead us to a closer, more fruitful, and more joyful relationship with Him. So our prayer ought to be thankful. Now you say, what does this have to do with the Holy Spirit? Well, just hold on for just one moment here as we go from thinking about thankful prayer to faithful prayer. This is where we start to get to where the Holy Spirit is just a blessing. Come back to Philippians 4. So if you want to go into Luke chapter 11, but hold your place in Philippians 4. Let's look here for just a minute. In Luke 11, Jesus gives us a lesson of importunity. Importunity, that is the fact that not taking no for an answer, but in a very positive way. There's a negative way about that. You know, when someone says no, no means no, right? But there are moments where we plead with somebody to say yes because the need is very important. Luke chapter 11, verse number 5. Look in this passage, and it says, Luke 11, verse 5, and He said to them, which of you shall have a friend and shall go unto him at midnight and say unto him, friend, lend me 3 loaves. For a friend of mine in his journey has come to me, and I have nothing to set before him. And he from within shall answer and say, trouble me not, the door is now shut. My children are with me in bed. I cannot rise and give thee. I say unto you, though he will not rise and give him because he is his friend, and because of his importunity, he will rise and give him as many as he needeth. Now this is the inverse of what we just mentioned. Oh, we ought to enter God's presence with thankful prayer, but we also ought to embrace faithful prayer. Faithful prayer. Faithful prayer is pictured here in this passage where Jesus talks about a friend who a man who has a friend, and all of a sudden he has a knock on his door or at midnight, and as that he enters the door, there is a friend of his who's come on a long journey. He's tired. He's hungry. And this man brings him in, and he goes to his cupboards and realizes, oh no, I don't have any food to give this guy. And when a person came to your house, the thought of hospitality was not to just let him in for a minute. No, you furnished him a place to rest, and you gave him something to satiate their hunger. You met their physical needs as the guest of your house. And he realized with some shame that he maybe forgot to go to the store that day and get some extra bread. So he thinks, well, you know what, I'm going to slip out the back real quick here and go to my neighbor's house, go to my friend's house. I know my friend will help me in my time of need, and I'll pay him back, no doubt, but I need something to sit before my friend who comes a long journey, and I don't want to go in and tell him I don't have anything to give him to eat or to satiate him. And so he slips out the back, and he goes down to his friend's house, and boy, it might be 12:30, 1 o'clock in the morning, I don't know, but he knocks on the door. Hey, friend, open up. I need your help. I've got a friend who came on a long journey, and I need some bread. And his friend calls out, do you know what time it is? It's 1 o'clock in the morning. Go back to bed. My kids are in bed. And you know how long it takes to put kids to bed sometimes? They're up. One, you get one in, and the other ones hop out. And it's almost like you're trying to wrestle a grease pig sometimes putting kids to bed. And so he said, look, I finally got my kids to bed. Our feet are washed. We're clean. We're asleep. I'm not getting up to give you bread. But every 5 seconds, Friend, can you please give me some bread? I don't want to walk in there and give nothing. Friend, will you please give me some bread? I don't want to go back empty-handed. Friend, will you please give me some bread? And finally, the neighbor, the friend, jumps out of bed and gets to his cupboard. He grabs the loaves. He takes them to his friend and says, look, just get out of here. And now it sounds chaotic. His friend had a need because he wanted to take care of somebody else. Now hold on. How many times have we lacked the wherewithal to meet the need of somebody else, whether it be a physical need or a spiritual need or an emotional need? And we try to muster something in our empty cupboards of our hearts instead of turning to God and letting God be the one to satiate us and give us what's needed to take and take to somebody else and fill them. And what burdens my heart today is that we have not gone to God and knocked at His door with importunity, not leaving until we have what we need. We open God's Word for 30 seconds, we read two or three verses, we spend 5 seconds in prayer, we walk out the door, and we mumble in our soul that God did not meet our needs today. And what God, Jesus is saying here is He's saying, look, let your prayer be like this friend who had a need, and come to God and knock on His door and knock on His door and knock on His door and knock on His door. Why? Because it's not a friend who's unkind. He's not a friend who is like a stubborn friend who is lazy and won't get up to help or interested. No. Look further on in the verse, in verse number 9. And I say unto you, ask and it shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For everyone that asketh receiveth, and he that seeketh findeth, and to him that knocketh it shall be opened. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will he give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he give him a serpent? Or if he ask for an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? And if he then being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? And so you think about verse 13, he says, look, God has good gifts to give you. God has a desire to fill you. God has a desire to meet your needs. And so if you are lacking something in your life or walk with God, don't be satisfied with 5 seconds or 10 seconds or 30 seconds in prayer. Get before the throne of God and knock and knock and knock and knock, because God wants to meet you and fill you. And He does it by His Holy Spirit. This brings about this last point of this thought of the importance of submitted prayer. Because I'm not talking about pounding down the door of heaven for a Starbucks coffee. What I'm talking about is when there's a legitimate need, whether it be an emotional need, a mental need, a spiritual need, physical need, we come before God pleading with Him to meet that need. But we don't always know what to pray for. If you turn your Bibles to Colossians chapter 1, you look in verse number 9, what Paul writes here. Colossians 1 and verse 9, he says, for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you, and to desire, here it is, that ye be filled with the knowledge of His will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing. Now, go to Romans chapter 8 here. Romans chapter 8. Hold your place in Colossians 1. We may be coming back to this next week because there's something amazing here to tie in as far as the thought of fruitfulness. But let's set the basis for that by Romans chapter number 8 with Colossians 1, okay? Romans chapter 8, let's go there for a moment. And in Romans chapter 8, in verse number 26, Paul writes here about the fact that in the previous verse about how creation, all of creation, is suffering the decay and the frailty of sin. All of that we see is affected by sin. All that we are has been affected by sin. Sin has permeated its dark, twisted fingers all through God's creation and has decayed and aged and hurt things. And so it's made it to where it is difficult to perceive in and of ourselves the mind of Christ and the will of God. And so when Paul's writing about this, he says that all creation groans for the day when all will be made new again. But he says in verse number 4 of chapter 8 that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. And so what he's saying here in this passage is he's saying, look, there's this internal struggle. Now there's a guarantee of victory for the believer who walks in the Spirit, but that guarantee is not there for somebody who is lost and apart from Christ. And the natural man understands or perceives not the things of the Spirit of God, but their foolishness unto him. We talked about that. No, we need the mind of Christ. We need to be led in the will of God. And so he says in verse number 26, he talks about this thought of infirmity. It's like being sick, being broken. And really we are. Until we get to heaven, until we are in a glorified body in the presence of God, we are broken. We're unable to really commune with God as he desires us to. He doesn't communicate with us now as he will. There's a whole bunch of things that are going to be a whole lot different and a whole lot better once we get to heaven. Amen. But in verse number 26, for now, he says, likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. Understand, we have an infirmity. We are, as 1 John 3, verses 2 through 3 says, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure. If we are to walk in the will of God, it will take time and prayer with God, aligning our hearts to the Word of God, and allowing our minds to be transformed by the Spirit of God. Why? Why? Because what Jesus said that the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of truth, is going to help us to understand the things that he gives to us. Look back with me again, back at John 16, as we get ready to close here. Back in John 16, you'll see it again. Back in John 16 and verse number 13. Howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come. He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine, and he shall show it unto you. One of the great blessings and one of the great tools of sanctification in the life of the believer by the Holy Spirit is prayer. It's that I'm praying with gratitude and importunity. But when I have no capability to discern what is right and what is the will of God, it is also that the Holy Spirit of God is praying and interceding on our behalf in a way that we never could. That's what Paul was saying in John 8, and that's what Jesus is referring to here, that he will function in this fashion as well. That, my friend, you can rest in the reality that God, the Godhead, the triune God of heaven, Father, Son, and Spirit, is at work not only meeting your needs, but interceding for your needs on your behalf. What a blessing. Those moments when I don't know how to pray for what I need, and God's Spirit just takes over in the background. And while it might be me sitting there in my mind thinking, oh God, I don't even know what to pray, the Holy Spirit in the background, in a way that we could never hear or understand, is talking to God, the Father, saying, this is what he needs. Would you provide it? Would you meet the need? Here it is. even when you don't know what to pray for, when I don't know what to pray for, the Holy Spirit knows how to pray. And when we let the, when we follow the leading of the Spirit in prayer, and when we follow the leadership of God through prayer, it will lead, as we'll see next week in Colossians 1, to a knowledge of the will of God, to discernment in the ways of God, to be pleasing in my walk with God, fruitful in my work for God, and grateful in my observation of God. These are the things, these are the fruit that will be produced by the Spirit in our lives by the tool of prayer. You know, 1 John chapter 5, verses 13 through 15 says this: "These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we desire of him." John says, you want to know that you're saved? You want to have confidence in your walk with God and in your relationship with God? Spend time in prayer. Prayer by God's will. It will only be accomplished if we pray in the Spirit, following the leadership of the Spirit, who will help us to understand how we ought to pray, what we ought to pray for. And even when we don't understand quite what it is to pray for, he'll be praying for us, and we'll see the will of God worked out in God's way and in God's time. And it provides great fruit and great joy. One of my most wonderful friends that I've had in the ministry was a man named Brother Sturgill. I miss Brother Sturgill. He passed away about a year ago now. And he was a member of my home church back in Chattanooga, Tennessee. And I'd see him, and when I'd see him, he'd say, "I'm praying for you." And I knew this man prayed. He prayed for very long periods of time. And I was on his regular prayer list, and I counted that a great privilege. And when he passed away, there was a sense of a void of prayer in my life in that area. I realized, and I miss Brother Sturgill's prayers for my family. Now, God used other people. But there are two people I knew that prayed for me like nobody ever prayed for me: my grandmother and Brother Sturgill. And they've gone to be with the Lord now. I miss them dearly. But you know, I'm thankful that though they might not be praying for me today like they were, God's Holy Spirit faithfully every day is with me in prayer to help me and guide me and lead me. But oh, that we'd listen to him. Oh, that we'd follow him. Oh, that we'd stop walking around moaning about how God doesn't do, or questioning the motives of God, or questioning the way of God, or trying to reinvent God because it doesn't fit our mold, it doesn't fit our thought of how he ought to do what he does, but rather that we would spend time in ardent, firm, faithful, importune prayer, seeking God's face, seeking God's will. And we'll talk a little more about that next week. But how about your prayer life today? What's it like? Do you spend time with God in prayer? Is it thankful prayer? Is it importune prayer? I know we all could grow in prayer. I'm not trying to say any of us got it figured out. But boy, we ought to repent of the thought of not being grateful in our prayer. And we ought to ask God to give us grace to be faithful and fervent in prayer. And I believe if we do, that God will meet us there by his Spirit. And he'll help us move forward in fruit and victory in the days to come. Let's stand together with our heads bowed and eyes closed. Father, we come to you now. We thank you for your love and goodness to us. Thank you for your great mercies. Lord, I pray that you'd watch over and guide the rest of the service today. Lord, I know that I come to you often seeking your face and wisdom. And Lord, these are not easy times. And God, I miss those that have passed on now that would often pray with me and for me with things. But Lord, I'm so thankful that your Spirit knows the things that I need. I'm so thankful that, Lord, your Spirit knows how to communicate these things to my soul, but more importantly, to your throne. God, help us all to grow in this thought of thankful and importune prayer. That we wouldn't be satisfied with trite prayers, with simple prayers, with general prayers, but God, that we would fervently seek your throne for specific, wonderful answers to prayer. That we might rejoice and praise you and give you glory in all these things. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you once more for being with us today. If you have any questions about anything, please don't hesitate to reach out. We'll trust, hopefully see you soon. We'll give you an update next time. We're thankful for each of you. Have a blessed day. Goodbye.